Siber Kahramanlar başlıklı sunumuyla Thomas de la Aguilera'yı alkışlarınızla sahneye davet etmek istiyorum. I would like to invite Mr. Aguilera to the stage for his presentation. Please welcome. Thank you very much. The floor is yours.
So, I had the opportunity of co-founding a cybersecurity company in the Silicon Valley. This was like 12 or 13 years ago. And I remember that I started doing presentations to customers, to the distribution channel, and then finally I started public speaking. So I remember one day that I had to give my first presentation in front of what I consider a very large audience. It was supposed to be like between 500 people and 1,000. So the night before, I didn't even get almost no sleep. I was so nervous and so scared. And I remember, finally, the day came, I show up like I did today here, like I'm doing right now. And it was maybe a room like this one. It's completely empty. There is one guy in the front row. I'm there confused. And then I realized that that's it. One guy came. So I gave my presentation to the best of my abilities. And when I finished, this guy, he comes to stage and he tells me, Tomás, thank you very much, because I loved your presentation. And I was like, oh, thank you very much to you. I feel flattered. So then we start talking, and we talk like for 5 minutes. And after 5 minutes, I tell him, okay, my friend, nice to meet you. I have to go. He looks at me, and he tells me, you are not going anywhere. What? He tells me, I'm the next presenter, and you are staying. So this is my way. Thank you. Thank you very much. So this is my way. I came all the way from Madrid. So that's it. This is my way of saying thank you to all of you for listening to me today. So actually, I'm going to start with my first job interview. I was 24 years old, this was 20 years ago, and the interviewer was Pepe Cea. He was gonna be later my boss. So I remember in the middle of the presentation, he grabs a piece of paper, he writes something down, and he gives it to me. I look at the paper, and Pepe tells me, okay, Tomás, what does that mean? I look again, x equals x plus 1. As I have a major in physics, I tell Pepe, okay, Pepe, from a mathematical standpoint, this equation doesn't make any sense. But in any programming language, when this line of code is executed, x will increment its value in one unity. He looks at me and he says, Tomás, you are hired. That's how I got my first job in Oracle. So I was confused and I asked him, okay, Pepe, why? Why are you hiring me? And he tells me, Tomás, this is gonna move the world. And 20 years later, I can tell you that Pepe was completely right. And today, this is moving the world. But for understanding this, I would like to start from the beginning. At the beginning, we were living there. We were living in nature. In this presentation, I'm going to call that Environment One. And actually, we've been designed as human beings for living in Environment One. So we've been living there for 200,000 years. And we've been designed for drinking water from rivers, picking our foods from trees, okay? So we have been designed, whether we like it or not, for living in environment one. It's like 3,000 years ago, we jumped into environment two, what I'm going to call in this presentation, environment two. This is towns and cities, like we know them today. So after living 3,000 years in environment two, we have not yet adapted to such an environment. Proof of that are cancer rates, autoimmune diseases, heart problems. All that is telling us that as humanity, we have not yet adapted to living in environment two. While all that is going on, we have jumped into a complete new environment and completely unprecedented for us, which I'm going to call in this presentation environment three, the digital world as we know it today. In the future, it will be the world of robotics and artificial intelligence. So every time I say environment three in this presentation, I will be talking about the information age and the digital world. So actually, just to frame it, the change, let's imagine that in environment two, in which we've been living for 2,000 years now, 3,000 years, sorry, let's imagine that the USA, for example, the USA and Europe were a country. So we will be talking about a country with 1 billion people. But in reality, we have borders, we have different languages, different laws, different rules, different societies. So, okay, that would be a huge country in environment two. But let's think in a country in environment three. If Facebook were a country in environment three, we would be talking about a country with 2 billion people. So today Facebook has 2 billion people, 2 billion users. Of course, there's no borders, there's no laws, there's no different cultures, so there's no barriers. And of course, information flows from Istanbul to Madrid, from Madrid to Barcelona, from Barcelona to Thailand, and from Thailand to Argentina in a matter of seconds. So it's such an environment that we don't even know how we are going to adapt as human beings to this new environment. And it's not just that environment three is growing. It's that it's growing in such a pace, so rapidly and so quickly, that it's completely unprecedented for us. Actually, for me, environment one and environment two are solid. Environment three, it's completely liquid. That's why it can grow so fast. So, for example, I remember when I arrived to the Silicon Valley and my boss there, Feliz Rivera, when I arrived, he got me a Motorola. It was year 2006, and he got me one of these Motorolas that you open like this, you know? It was like the latest phone in the market. So I was very happy with my Motorola. And if there is any developers here in the room, so if we think in the operating system of that Motorola, we are talking about 10,000, maybe 10,000 lines of code. Okay, it was very small operating system, and of course, no apps. Then 1 year later, Steve Jobs released the first iPhone. And I remember Felice, like I used to call him, he got himself the first iPhone. He was in love with that device. And I remember he used to come every day to my desk and he was like, you know what, Tomás? I'm so happy with you that as an MBO managed by objectives, he told me, as an MBO, I'm going to get you an iPhone. I was like, okay, Felice, I don't want to let you down, but I don't care, you know? It's a very cool device, very cool hardware, but I don't care about the iPhone. Please, get me a house in Hawaii, if you wish, but I don't want an iPhone. The next day, he comes to me, he comes to my desk, Tomás, today I'm going to get you an iPhone. Okay, Felice, he was my boss, I have to be careful. Okay, thanks, Felice, I really appreciate it, but I don't see the value, you know, I don't want an iPhone. We were like that, like, for 2 months. After 2 or 3 months, he gave up. And he was like, okay, he doesn't want an iPhone. Four months later, I go to his office because there is something that completely changed my mind. One thing happened that completely changed my mind. And I show up in his office, and even though he was my boss, I was like, Felice, move right now from your chair. Let's take me to the closest Apple store because you are going to get me an iPhone right now. He's like, what's going on with this crazy Spaniard? He's, why? I was like, I don't have time, sorry, my friend. I don't have time to explain. I will explain in the car. He's confused. So he's driving to the closest Apple store and he asked me, okay, crazy Spaniard, why now you want so desperately the iPhone? And I told him, look, Felice, today Steve Jobs, Apple, released the SDK for the iPhone. SDK stands for Standard Development Kit, which means that anyone in the world, in Turkey, in Spain, in the UK, wherever, anyone can develop an app for this device. And I told him, that is going to change the world. And of course, it did. So Steve Jobs was creating a platform in Environment 3 in which the lines of code that we have in these devices today, it's millions of lines of codes, which is great. And it's making our lives easier, you know? But from a cybersecurity standpoint, this environment free growth doesn't go alone. It goes with a lot of threats. So the number of threats we had in that Motorola were extremely limited, maybe none. In the iPhone, in any smartphone, Android device, we can have today, and we have today, thousands of threats. So this is the any smartphone, but this is talking about phones and smartphones. What about smart buildings? So let's say that maybe now we are choosing our house in environment two, of course, depending of whether it is in Istanbul or it is in Madrid or it is in Barcelona or wherever. Maybe in the future we're going to choose our house depending on the operating system, the same way we choose our iPhone or our phone, our smartphone today. We're going to choose our home based on the operating system and on which apps I can install or what cybersecurity it's implemented in this smart building if I'm going to work in it, or in this house, if my kids are going to live in it. So the same is going to be true for smart cities. Actually, Catalonia is in the news these days. And Barcelona, for example, it has its own operating system. So it's a city with an operating system, which it's very good. But that means that we have part of the city in environment two and part of the city in environment three, which is great, but from a cybersecurity standpoint, if Barcelona, for example, the operating system of that smart city gets hacked, what can happen with the critical infrastructures? So we have to think in all those threats. Not to say that, for example, this was the slide for smart cities, and we are going to jump into the Internet of Things. I chose this slide because it has a heart. So unfortunately for me, I have to be very careful with my heart. My dad died when he was 46 because of his heart, his dad when he was 57, and like that, every man in my dad's family. So who knows? I'm thinking that maybe 2 years from now, my heart will be part of the Internet of Things, which is great. But from a cybersecurity standpoint, we have to be extremely aware of the risk. So actually, one of my colleagues in the Master in Cybersecurity in IE, his name is Ramses Gallego, and he's an evangelist for Symantec. He's an amazing speaker. He calls, so for example, if I ask any one of you, what does IoT mean? Probably all of you will say the Internet of Things. For him, and I'm borrowing from him this term, he calls IoT the Internet of Threats or the Internet of Trouble. So anytime we think in environment three, we have to be aware that it has to go with cybersecurity. Because if not, it will turn into what Gianluca D'Antonio, the academic director for the Master in Cybersecurity at IE, calls the digital jungle. So today, environment three has grown so fast and so rapidly that it has turned into the digital jungle. And from a cybersecurity standpoint, a digital jungle can be very dangerous. So we all in the IT industry have to work on this digital jungle to make it a safe environment for humanity, because we are all living in environment three these days. So actually, from a risk or a threat standpoint, if we think in the three environments, in environment one, maybe we perform a risk analysis, we could think in, okay, what are the threats? Okay, maybe the threat is if I get eaten by a lion. Okay, that was the threat. Then we jumped into environment two. And of course, the number of threats increased. If we performed a risk analysis in environment two, we had some more threats, not that many. So for example, if I perform a risk analysis 2 days ago, I could think, okay, I'm gonna go to Turkey. So, okay, I'm at my home in Madrid. Okay, maybe I can have an accident in the taxi in my way to the airport. And maybe my plane can crash. That was it. Okay, two risks. Okay, I can handle that. What about if probably many of you are running data centers, or maybe you are CIOs, or you are working for large organizations or the government? If you perform a risk analysis in environment three, the number of risks you get, it's completely huge. It's thousands and thousands and thousands. So the number of risks that we are facing as humanity in environment three is unprecedented. And I'm not only talking quantity. If we think in quality, it's exactly the same. The complexity and the sophistication of these threats in environment three is as well completely unprecedented for the human beings. So if we are in environment three, doing online banking with our iPhone, maybe working in our CRM in the cloud, running a data server, a web server, doing infrastructure as a service in the cloud, whatever we are doing in environment three, we have to know one thing as a matter of fact, that cyber attacks are just ahead. So if we are in environment three, we have to know one thing, and that's gonna be for sure, is that we are gonna get attacked. So actually today, this is, I'm borrowing this slide from Ramsés Gallego. To be honest, I'm a big fan of Ramsés. I have no words for him, he's the best. So he's done this exercise. So these are like the 36 main threats that are attacking us today in environment three. So one of the questions we can make ourselves today is that why? Why there are so many threats in environment three? So you are too many, I cannot ask you why, but if I would ask you why, it's like, okay, why in environment one I had these threats? One in environment two, I had this, okay, some more threats, but not that many. And suddenly, we as humanity jumped into a complete new environment, and suddenly it's all about cybercrime. And the number of threats had increased like dramatically. The answer is very easy. So for example, in my previous slide, I was showing a guy with a thing in his head, with a gun, and probably he was robbing a bank. So if you want to perform an attack in environment two, at least you have to be very brave, and you need weapons. I don't know, it's not easy at all. If you want to perform an attack in environment three, all you need is this. All you need is a keyboard. And it doesn't matter where you are. You can be in Madrid, and you can be attacking a device, a server, a workstation, and you don't even know where it is. You just are attacking an IP address. So it's so easy to perform an attack in environment three that this is the reason why we are getting those many attacks. So actually, environment three is changing everything as we knew it. So one of, I will speak later a little bit about David Sancho. He's a senior threat researcher that I also admire a lot. And one day he was asking me, okay, Tomás, I had my computer here, and he was asking me, okay, Tomás, so if an attacker is hacking this device right now, what is he getting? Can he do something to you physically? Can he steal your watch? Can he steal your pocket, maybe, your iPhone? I was like, no. And he told me, look, Tomás, the only thing an attacker can steal in any cyber attack is information. So the only thing these guys are looking for, the cyber attackers, is information. But of course, in environment three, we have three things: power, money, and information. So actually, power and money were important in environment two. In environment three, all we need is information. Information in environment three is the new currency, is power and money. So any cyber attack, and it's incredible for me, is just looking for information. So actually, when I came from Madrid, I came, of course, by plane. And I remember one day, I don't know where I was flying to, but I was about to jump into a plane, like this one. And I remember my mom, it was like 10 years ago, I think I was in the US at that time, and my mom calls me. Okay, my son, where are you? And I tell her, mom, I'm just about to jump into a plane. Can I call you later when I land? And she's like, of course, she's very scared of flying and of planes. And she's like, okay, Tomás, what airline are you gonna use? So, because she's so scared that if I tell her an airline, like a low-cost airline, she would be extremely scared. Why? Because security and aviation goes completely together. So if it's not because of security, none of us here will take a plane. None of us. And we take a plane today, and we go 10,000 feet high, because it is safe. So exactly the same is happening today with environment three. This is a SOC, a security operation center. So actually, if it were not because of cybersecurity, environment three will not be happening. So it's funny because most of the society is not even aware of cybersecurity. But all the digital transformation that the previous speakers were talking about and that we are living as individuals, as organizations, as companies and governments, all that will not be happening if it were not because of cybersecurity. And of course, cybersecurity will not be happening if it were not thanks to cyber heroes. So actually, this is David Sancho, a senior threat researcher. I talked about him before. He was one of my colleagues in my previous company, and I'm a huge admirer of David. He's one of the smartest guys I have ever met. And I really think, because in the future, environment two, every prediction is telling us that in the future, environment two and environment three are gonna be completely interwoven, are gonna be almost the same, you know? So I'm really convinced that humanity is gonna need cyber heroes to be safe, like David Sancho. That's why At IE, we came up with a Master in Cybersecurity in order to help individuals become cyber heroes. So actually, I was having a coffee with Gianluca D'Antonio, the academic director for the Master in Cybersecurity at IE. It was like 2 weeks ago. And so I've been working for vendors, cybersecurity vendors, for the last 15 years. So the last 15 years, most of my time, it's been spent in selling cybersecurity solutions and products. So Gianluca, 2 weeks ago, he tells me, okay, Tomás, you know what? Cybersecurity is not about cyber products or cybersecurity solutions. And I'm like, what? And he tells me, you know, Tomás, cybersecurity is about cyber heroes. Thank you very much.